When the MI6, NATO designation Hook, took flight in 1957, it was the largest helicopter in the world. Its robust construction and heavy lift capabilities meant it saw service from the tundra of Siberia to the rainforest of North Vietnam and to the deserts of Egypt. The MI6's development started in the early half of the 1950s. The Soviet Army needed a helicopter capable of transporting a lot of troops, and the civilian market needed a helicopter that was capable of carrying large loads over long distances. Design work took an impressive 1 year. From there, construction and fine-tuning of 5 prototypes took 3 years, an impressive achievement given not only the size of the aircraft, but also its long service life. It could have flown sooner had it not been for problems developing the main rotor blades. After 2 years of testing, the MI6 entered production in 1959. The Soviet Armed Forces were in such desperate need for a heavy lift helicopter that the government decided to begin production before the official tests were completed. One feature that was tested on the second MI6 prototype that gives some MI6s a rather distinct silhouette is its stubby wings. The stubby wings had a wingspan of 15.3 meters or 50 feet, and at the MI6's maximum speed of 300 kilometers an hour or 186 miles per hour, provided an impressive 25% of the lift. Up until 1966, these stubby wings were variable incidence, meaning that they could change their angle in relation to the body of the helicopter. However, it was found that the helicopter's flight performance did not change significantly enough to warrant the complexity of the operation. After 1966, the design was simplified to fixed wings, with the left wing having an angle of incidence of 14.5 degrees and the right wing 15.45 degrees. It should be noted that not all MI6s had stub wings. When the MI6 was in its heavy lift configuration, the wings were removed, giving it increased lifting capacity. In a hover, the stub wings provided 800 kilograms of drag. The Hook had a top speed of 300 kilometers an hour, or 186 miles per hour, and a cruise speed of 250 kilometers an hour, or 155 miles per hour. It had a maximum internal payload of 12,000 kilograms, or 26,455 pounds, and a maximum slung payload of 8,000 kilograms, or 17,637 pounds. A long list of militaries used the MI6. I'd like to note the North Vietnamese's use of the MI6. The North Vietnamese Air Force received their Hooks in 1964, and it gave the North Vietnamese an incredible tool for carrying large and high priority cargo, including SA-2s, other anti-air platforms, and heavy materials, including artillery pieces. The MI6 also conducted 400 lifts of MiG-17s during the war. The NVAF was aided by the fact that the US were not allowed to engage MI6s. The MI6 stayed in service with the NVAF until the 1990s, an impressive service life. The Soviet military used the Hook for transportation of equipment, personnel, refueling military vehicles in forward areas, forest firefighting, and recovery of Soyuz capsules. One of the more delicate missions assigned to the Hook was the transportation of nuclear warheads from depots to airfields and launch sites. In the civilian market, the Hook proved vital in the Soviet Union as they expanded their infrastructure deep into the Russian wilderness. It aided in constructing research stations for geologists deep in the Siberian taiga. A special version was developed in 1965 for Aeroflot that had an airline-style interior and could accommodate 70 to 80 passengers. It was fitted with a toilet, galley, and soundproofing. Another interesting prototype was the MI6 PZH, which was a firefighting variant. However, the first prototype was destroyed in a crash in the south of France whilst fighting a forest fire. The idea was sound, however, so a number of MI6 firefighters were built by conversion, being fitted with a nozzle where the navigator sits. It could carry 12 tons of water and retardant fluid. Another interesting variant was the MI6 PS, which was a search and rescue variant, primarily intended to recover Soviet cosmonauts. A rather fascinating variant was the MI6M, an anti-submarine variant that could mount 4 torpedoes. It was designed to carry a towed array, However, development took too long and the project was scrapped. When I think of anti-submarine helicopters, I think of the Seahawk and the Ka-27, both of which are small, ship-based helicopters, so the idea of a large, land-based anti-sub heli is interesting to me. The Soviets tried a ton of different ideas with the Hook, from fuel transport to electronic jamming to command posts. The MI6 proved to be a very stable platform at cruising speeds. However, at slow speeds, undesired vibrations appeared. At max takeoff weight, the MI6 was underpowered, so pilots would have to do rolling takeoffs and landings just to get off the ground. One of the major complaints with the heli was the D-25V turboshafts, which were prone to disintegrating if oversped, often causing the loss of the aircraft. The MI6 was not perfect for heavy lift. The inability for the crew to actually see the cargo and its intended final destination made it difficult for pilots to place cargo with high precision. The Soviet solution was the MI-10, which drew heavily from the MI-6, utilizing the same power plant, rotor head, and tail unit. The MI-10, NATO designation Haki, had a slim fuselage which sat on four tall undercarriage legs, which allowed the Haki to taxi over payloads. It was used in a similar capacity as the MI-6, mainly for scientific and engineering applications. The MI-10 was moderately successful, with a few variants produced, including the MI-10P, which had an electronic countermeasures pod mounted underneath, and the MI-10UPL, which had a scientific laboratory underneath. The Soviet military used the Haki for the transportation of equipment that did not fit into the MI-6. One MI-10 actually saw service in the war in Afghanistan in 1980. The helicopter was primarily used for the transportation of bulky cargo. Its service life, however, was short-lived, as during the summer of the same year, it suffered an engine failure whilst carrying a MAZ 500 tanker. The crew tried to make an emergency landing, but after coming over a crest, they were met with a boulder field, which proved to be fatal for the long-legged MI-10. A second MI-10 was sent to Afghanistan, and it stayed in theater for 4 years. But during one of its flights, it was engaged by snipers. The flight technician was killed and the heli's equipment was damaged. It was later sent back to the motherland. The MI-6 was used in Chernobyl to pour thousands of tons of boron and sand onto reactor debris. The sand was to stop fires and prevent additional releases of radioactive material, whilst the boron was used to stop further nuclear reactions. Interestingly, the MI-6's replacement, the MI-26, carried out a bulk of the work in Chernobyl. The MI-26 could hover over the exposed reactor and drop loads with a 100% success rate. The MI-6 could not hover and had to drop their loads at a speed of 60 kilometers an hour or 40 miles per hour, so their success rate was only 50%. Crews had to be rotated out when their radiation doses got too high. It was said that the helicopters used for this operation had received so much radiation on their underbelly that the grass underneath them would turn yellow after 2 days. The helicopters also suffered a lot of damage from radioactive material being ingested by the engines. The helicopters were so contaminated from radiation that they were deemed unfit to be ever flown again and were placed in purpose-built vehicle graveyards. I was hoping to find more details on the flight performance of the MI6. I would love to know how quickly you could descend and how easy it was to enter vortex ring state. As with a lot of Soviet military technology, information is scarce, which is a shame, as the MI6 seemed like a real truck of the skies. It had features like clamshell doors around the engines that allowed engineers to stand on them, allowing for easy field maintenance. It was robust, strong, and versatile. It aided in the Soviets' expansion deep into the Russian wilderness and helped with the construction of countless oil pipelines across Russia. The MI6 was so successful that around 926 were produced between 1959 and 1980. However, in 2002, a tragic accident occurred in the Tamir Peninsula, resulting in the loss of 16 geologists and 5 crew, Consequently, the Interstate Aviation Committee revoked the MI6's type certificate, a tragic end to a real workhorse of the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union still had a need for a heavy-lift helicopter, and in the 80s, the MI6's replacement was developed, that being the MI26, which is still the largest and fastest production helicopter. It's not hard to see the MI6's roots in the MI26. The MI26 is a rather interesting helicopter that has done some incredible missions. I will be doing a video on it soon. I hope you enjoyed this video. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and I'll see you next time.